We're grateful for all of you being here. For you who are online, we're glad that you're participating in the service. Check in with us on that, would you? Mark, would you turn that on? I don't have a monitor. Check in with us. Just acknowledge that you're there. We like to know who and how many and so forth. And if you have a need, use the texting that's showing on the screen from time to time. For those of you who are here, it will show from time to time, like right now. Thank you, Mark. And what we're doing is giving people an opportunity for feedback and to ask questions and so forth as well. So please take advantage of that. We actually pay a company to have that. And if you haven't signed up for the texting that we do, there's a sheet back there on that table. It's about yay big, and it says that you want to get into texting so you can get messages when we have something. Like if we have a big snowstorm, may it not happen, then we would give you updates. The parking lot is not being cleared yet. If you want to try, we'll be there for the service, but we can't guarantee. Or the parking lot's clear, the entries are good, y'all come, you know. So we can use that for quick communication, which we can't do otherwise. And after the commercial, we will get down to doing some singing. You'll notice we have a couple of patriotic type songs in here. And there's a reason for that. It has to do with the direction of the message this morning. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crowned thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Oh, beautiful for pilgrim feet whose stern impassioned stress a thoroughfare for freedom beat across the wilderness. America, America, God mend thine every flaw, confirm thy soul in self-control, thy liberty in law. I do like that second verse an awful lot, because it's the prayer we should be praying to our God all the time for our land. God bless America. We're going to sing it. Our request of him. America, land that I love, stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the ocean white with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home. Amen. May he do that exactly. We've a story to tell to the nations. Stone.
glory to tell to the nations that shall turn their hearts to the right. A story of truth and mercy, a story of peace and light. A story of peace and light, for the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright. And Christ's great kingdom shall come to earth, the kingdom of love and light. We've song to be sung to the nations that shall lift their hearts to the Lord. A song that shall conquer evil and shatter the spear and sword. And shatter the spear and sword. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright. And Christ's great kingdom shall come to earth, the kingdom of love and light. These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, so we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
I've seen this done by the troops. If you've not seen that, we'll have to get that and we'll sing it with them sometime. But these are soldiers, and they are singing this song, and I mean they get with it. They are jumping and moving and alive, and then they have the little ending. We just got that in, and we're learning it. But they start singing in a kind of a chant. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. Like that. It just does that for a moment. And it's moving. I mean, I can't watch that with those men doing that without getting tearful about it like I'm doing now. Move to the next song, please. I don't have Dorothy up here to help me. I've got to control myself. We'll go two times through this. All hail King Jesus. All hail Emmanuel. King of kings, Lord of lords, bright morning star. And throughout eternity, I'll sing his praises.
and I'll reign with him throughout eternity. All hail King Jesus, all hail Emmanuel, King of kings, Lord of lords, bright morning star. Sing his praises, and I'll reign with him throughout eternity.
Amen. Amen. Let's skip the next one and move to a verse of the battle hymn.
Have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath were stored. He has loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
Let's go to the next verse.
I have seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I have been tonight a sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
Everything that marches on ought to be with God's truth as at the heart of it. We're going to sing one verse of How Great Thou Art.
I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout this universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen. Thank you all. Dorothy is not up here sharing this week. We think we finally found what caused her the trouble the last time and the trouble this time. They gave her the same anesthetic and then worked on her tooth. We thought the infections twice had attacked her, and they probably did, but the major problem was the anesthetic, according to a doctor that we went twice to the emergency room in the past 2 weeks, and the second one was young fellow, his name's Dr. So, and he's up here at Belton, and we had quit using Belton until we found Dr. So, and he was most beneficial to us in explaining the problem and sent us back to talk to the dentist about what he was using on Dorothy. So we're grateful she's here today. She's a great light in my life, and I'm just really glad to have her sharing in this service. We are going to talk about pulpit freedom. And particularly emphasis on freedom as United States of America. Let's have a moment of prayer, if we could, before entering into the message right now. Our Lord and God, we come to you as a people in need of your help, in need of your blessing, looking for you to give us strength and courage and understanding. And above all, Lord, give us the truth. We pray in the name of the one who is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. America the Beautiful, we sing. But America the Beautiful is in the process of dying. And America the Beautiful has 300,000 pulpits in it who won't say a thing. They are frightened to silence. The government and concern for our popularity causes us not to deal with hard subjects sometimes. But today there are 4,000 precious innocent lives taken every day from the unborn of this land. And 300,000 pulpits are mostly silent. Teenage suicide is at an all-time high, and 300,000 pulpits are silent about the cause. Rape is 700% higher in the last 50 years, and 300,000 pulpits are silent. All kinds of things, such as rock music and other forms of the art, legitimize rape, murder, forced sex, sadomasochism, adultery, sex change, satanic worship, and 300,000 pulpits are silent. The majority of states now have lotteries for gambling, which takes money out of homes and leaves people broke. Folks, they don't all win, even though they brag that they do. And we have 300,000 pulpits that are not doing a thing about it. We are opening our borders to sex trafficking and drug smuggling, not to mention terrorist cell groups that could be infiltrating the country and turn us to looking at something that makes 9/11 look like a Sunday school picnic. Let's get it, people. We need to get to the truth. We need to live with the truth that God has given us. We must not turn our back on that. This country was founded on what the scriptures say. But we fear persecution and rejection. That's sad. That's sad. I want to speak directly to any minister who happens to see this service recorded, and speak to myself. The soul of our nation is at stake. Get out of the bleachers and get in the game. We must stand up for Jesus Christ. We must do it loud and long in order to change what has taken place. Now, we have at our hands the very thing that can help us turn this country around. What we need is a revival. We need a big, strong revival. And you know how revival can come? It can only come if the people can speak out. And guess what? We have the right to speak out on behalf of Jesus. We have the necessity to speak out. There's something in what's called the First Amendment. Have you ever heard of that? You hear a lot about it because the press says that they've got every right in the world to say anything they want to, anytime they want to, and they're going to do it. But it says in that this, and this is taking it right in order, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion. Huh. No law. Well, that sounds fine. But that's where they stop. Bless their gizzards. They've missed it. It's way, 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 way beyond that. You see, nor shall they make a law respecting the establishment of religion, or, get this, prohibiting the free exercise thereof. You got that? They intended that we be free to express ourselves, to carry the message about Jesus to the world, to stand up for right, and to stand against what is wrong. And we have a problem with that in this country. Something that just came out to me this past week. There is a congressional committee, actually subcommittee, I guess it is, and their job is the weaponization of the federal government. They're dealing with that. The head of that group says this: have you bought a Bible? If so, the federal government may be coming for you. The U.S. Treasury Department, get this, believe it or not, is now asking banks to report anyone who buys a Bible to the Financial Crimes Enforcement Network. Got it? Use that right to speak up. And it's not just Bibles, they're after firearms on the same list. You know where we are now with the book? It's the sword. And they don't like the puncture marks that it leaves in their ideals. We need to make sure that we stand up and are heard. Have you ever heard of the power of the pulpit? It's greatly lacking in our times, sadly lacking in our times. It's been called the sacred desk. Ezra, in Nehemiah, the book of Nehemiah, stood up, and it says he stood on a pulpit of wood. Now, don't picture me standing up on this thing. I'm not going there. But what it meant was they built a raised platform up so he could be heard by the people. That was the point. Pulpits take a lot of different forms. There's nice oak ones. There's plexiglass ones, clear see-through. There are ones where you run up a flight of steps and you stand like you're standing in the prow of a boat and you preach from that position. In Europe, I'm told that they have pulpits carved from stone and they preach from behind those. Be good if people are throwing things. And then, of course, there's what we have. We use them for music racks here, but I've preached from and taught from these little simple adjustable to height pulpits. Jesus didn't even need a pulpit. He sat on the mountainside and he taught. He did that more than once. He went into the upper room and he taught there and had a pulpit there. He taught about the Lord's Supper and he taught about servanthood in a way that the disciples would never forget. Jesus was arrested. He was taken to the high priest's court, the governor's palace. And Jesus, before them, complied with their statement that he was the Messiah. He went to the cross, and the cross became his pulpit. And he offered forgiveness to his torturers and a prayer for them to our God. And there, he gave hope to a dying thief. The power of the pulpit, though, does not rest then with the object. It rests with the truth itself that must come from it. This is what we need to have in our minds, the truth of God. The Apostle Paul spoke about this. He reflected on it in 1 Corinthians, the second chapter. He said, "When I came to you, I did not come with eloquence or human wisdom, as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God." Paul stuck to the facts. He stuck to the facts. He proclaimed the wisdom of God. We need to be doing that today. And we need to do it without backing down from whomever is in power, from whomever is going to come after us. I've got to admit, I have a chicken spirit sometimes. I would like to be liked, and it ain't easy for me. But that's not what it's about. What it's about is truth. And the truth must be taught, and the truth must come out, and we must be pleasing to our Heavenly Father. He goes on in that second chapter of Corinthians, "I resolved to know nothing while I was with you, except Christ and Him crucified." That is getting to the truth. "I came to you in weakness, with great fear and trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power." And he's talking about the Spirit penetrating mankind's heart and leading mankind to do right things. He didn't view conversion as his work. He viewed that as the work of the Holy Spirit. He viewed getting the Holy Spirit's words out to people as the key. "So that your faith," he says further, "might not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power." He wants people to place their faith not in a preacher and his wisdom, but in God and his wisdom. This is what we must accomplish. Truth is in short supply. Lying is popular. We must stand for the truth. We must not let anything prohibit the free exercise thereof, of the Word of God being taught in this land. God's truth must be taught. When Paul was on trial, he was before the men who had his life in their hands. And what did he do? He shared with them about what righteousness was, what about moral holiness to two men who had none, and about judgment. That's preaching the truth, even in times when we don't have the opportunity of freedom resting on us, but we're imprisoned. We need desperately to return to that kind of courage. We need pulpit freedom. We need to preach truth. I'd like to spend the rest of our time just looking at truth. And I'll try to do this in the remaining 15 minutes. If you pray hard enough and I preach fast enough, we might make it. I want to address the issues of truth for America. Truth. We must repent of not calling sin, sin. We must turn from sin and help people turn from sin so that they can take up their cross and follow Jesus Christ. In Matthew, the 16th chapter, we find that they were taught that the truth must be coming out. They were taught by Jesus. And he was teaching him that as he was looking at a cross. Truth. We must not reject truth for sinful lies. You want the best example? Garden of Eden. What did Satan do? He changed evil to good. That's what he did. He said, "See that tree? See that tree? Eve, look at that tree. That'd make the best pie you ever saw if you could just pick that fruit and feed it to Adam and yourself. It'll be great." And he said, "This tree that God says is going to get you into trouble, is only about you knowing as much as God. Wouldn't you like to know as much as God? And this reached her, and she reached Adam. Today we see that the word that's being spoken in our society changes all the time. Have you ever heard of reproductive rights? Some of these terms are stupid. They're plain stupid. You always had reproductive rights. A marriage license assured it. And then you reproduce. That's good. Reproductive rights. But today they don't mean that. They mean that you should have the right to interfere with the process of a child being born. We're talking about abortion. Now, abortion is a nasty word. You know why? Because it's sneaky. Okay, we did our best to reach them, but the waves became so intense that we were afraid we would be crashed on the rocks in attempting the rescue. So we aborted the mission in order to keep the crew members alive. That sounds like a good cause. Aborting something, dropping something to make something go right. We've gone down the slippery slope, and we're still on the slide as a country. How do you debate with somebody? You change the labels. That's the way they do. You don't even know what they're talking about sometimes. And if all else fails, you just lie. It seems like we had the highest person in the land lied about Benghazi. And then to cover the lie, he made another lie. The sharp mind of that man could only come out with an answer to Congress, "I don't recall." I don't recall. We recall everything that comes into our life, and we recall the ugly more than we recall the good. Do you realize that? It stays with us. That's why soldiers come back from war and spend years getting well from having been in such a conflagration as they were in. I one time was talking about a ball game that was played. Ronnie Epps played in it. Some of you know him. He's years older than I am. He was a double A level shortstop in the Cardinal system. Ronnie was a preacher, and we were having our big annual preacher student ball game, and we beat him in 7 innings. And Ronnie walked out and he said, "Come on, you guys." Now, the students had never won that game. We had some players, and we pounded them. He said, "Come on, you guys, let's go on to 9 innings. We've got time for it." And I grabbed hold of the co-captain with me, and I said, "No, Max, no." And Ronnie said, "Oh, yeah, come on." And Bob Lytle threw in, and he said, "Come on, Max, are you a sissy or something? Can't you hold out 2 more innings? And they beat us by 1 run. Now, I've never forgotten that. I told that the first time, and Connie was my spouse at the time, and bless her heart, she looked up at me and she said, "You can remember a ball game from that far back?" So when somebody pops up and says, "I don't recall, I don't recall," they're saying, "I'm going to lie, I'm going to lie." That's it. Truth is what we need to deal in. Truth is what we need to insist upon. We have what's called political correctness. It is a despotic power to erase morality, nothing else. It is to be intolerant of those who are intolerant of sin. That's all it is. We need to speak the truth. Parsing of words is nuts. Simply having them have the meaning that they have is what we need. Truth is truth. all the talking that's done for spin, my goodness, it's utterly ridiculous. Demand the truth. We must demand truth, lest we approve of greed and allow continued failure on the part of our leadership. Let me ask you a question. Just give it some thought. Please don't answer out loud. Did you ever see a destitute congressman or senator? Now, why do they restructure what they restructure? Why do they move away from Christian values? We need to deal in the truth of God. We need to make it clear what the truth of God is. Truth is that the government wants us to violate our religious conscience. They pass things into law that they expect us to pay for with our taxes and make no complaint. We need a conscience that's trained in the Word of God, that's trained in leading people in the Word of God, that's trained in bringing people to the truth of God and to the salvation of our God. Conscience is training in the Word of God. We need to be led by the Spirit of God. We need to be God's children, doing what God wants and expects of us. We need truth. We need people to wake up. In the scriptures, it says this in 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray, then will I hear their prayers and heal their land. That's where we've got to go to make a difference. This country was founded on Christian principles. Christian principles. I'm skipping over a whole section here by just saying that. But you know that. I know that. Preachers at the time of the American Revolution were the strongest backers of that revolution. King George said, after the war was lost, to his people, if it wasn't for that black-robed regiment, referring to the ministry of America, if it wasn't for that black-robed regiment, I would still hold that country. You got what did it? It was people with the courage to stand up for truth and lead in a battle for freedom. It said that as they fought the Revolutionary War, a battle came down to where there was a church on a hill, and down below it was a fence that went clear around it, a rock wall. And behind that, the American troops fought. They were fighting with those old muskets, you know. And you know what the musket takes? Powder, some kind of stuffing down there, paper or something of that type, and the ball. That's the way they fire. They will not work without all of that. And so, as they fought, the preacher noticed that the gunfire was slowing down. And he hollered out, "What's wrong down there? What's happening?" And they said, "We're out of paper." And here he came running with his arms full. And he crawled behind the lines as the bullets ripped around everybody there. And he kept ripping out pages out of the hymn books from the church and handing them to the people and saying, give them the love of Jesus, and handed it to them again and again, and risked his life in that battle. The founders of this country knew and believed that for our government to work, we had to be controlled from within by God. You can't handle freedom unless you are controlled from within by God. You will not handle it in your home. You will not handle it in your job. You will not handle it anywhere aright. What do we need? God control. Not somebody's made up rules for God, but his rules, led by his Spirit, following his way. Let America be America again. Let America move to truth and an allegiance to the one who said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. O Lord, bless us that we may stand for truth, that we may stand for you, that we may carry your word to a world that's lost. Help us, Father. Help us to be your people. Help us to do your work. And God, bless our pulpits, that the truth flows continuously from them. And we pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. We're going to extend an invitation for those who want to make decisions. For those of you who are at home, you can make a decision by just texting us and letting us get back with you and share in that decision with you. For those of you who are here, you can come forward and share your decision and your need, and we will pray with you, receive you, whatever it is that needs to be done in your life today. Let's join in singing song, Come to Jesus. Weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die, oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. You can make a decision at any time that you want to until Jesus comes again. I encourage you to make yours as soon as possible if that's your need. Contact us, talk with us. We'd love to share with you about our Savior. We're going to receive the Lord's Supper at this time. And we will sort of sing our meditation, Come Share the Lord. We gather here in Jesus' name. His love is burning in our hearts like living flame. For through the loving Son, the Father makes us one. Come take the bread, come drink the cup, come share the Lord. No one is a stranger here. Everyone.
here, we can then improve all wrongs. He joins us here, he breaks the bread. The Lord who pours the cup is risen from the dead. The one we love the most is now our gracious host. Come drink the cup, come drink the cup, come share the Lord. We are now a family of which the Lord is head. Us here in the breaking of the bread. We'll gather soon where angels sing. We'll see the glory of our Lord and coming King. Now we anticipate the feast for which we wait. Come take the bread, come drink the cup, come share the Lord. Come take the bread, come drink the cup, come share the Lord.
We praise God that we can participate in this feast that's emblematic of the feast to come. The feast in heaven, the sharing in heaven, the celebration with millions and millions, myriads and myriads, as the scriptures say, of people gather there to honor the Lamb of God, sacrificed for our sins so we can be present. Looking forward to that time, we now participate. Let's take the bread, Lord. We take this in remembering Jesus. And above all, we remember his blood, Lord, shed for us on Calvary with the cup. Thank you, Lord, for that covenant. You guys got really fortunate. I don't know who was praying so hard out there that I would finish that in time. But I lost one page of my manuscript here somewhere. Power of prayer. Never, never, never doubt it. I wonder what I was going to say. We thank God for our gathering and sharing together in Christ. We're grateful for your participation, who are online. We are blessed by both. If you can get where you can get here, get here. There's something special about greeting these people. These people are friendly. They are really worth coming to meet and enjoy and be blessed by. I want to state, as you're going out, that on my left pocket of my shirt, that is not my poor eating. My pen leaked ink into my pocket just about the time we were starting our study this morning. I couldn't figure out why it felt wet. I hadn't had tea near me for 30 minutes. So I just want you to know, I didn't do it. This is not the result of Dorothy not being able to take care of my clothes. She's not able to do that quite yet, but it's just simply the pen leaks. Let's have our closing prayer together. Father, thank you for the one who is the truth and the life. He is the way to you, and we're so grateful for that. We ask you to bless us, to lead others in that path. Bless us to encourage others to worship with us, to know Jesus. We thank you, Father, for his power given to us to save us from our sins. Help us to take that message to the world, we pray in His holy name. Amen.
Get all excited, go tell everybody that Jesus Christ is King. I said, get all excited, go tell everybody that Jesus Christ is King. I said, get all excited, go tell everybody that Jesus Christ is King. Jesus Christ is still the King of Kings, King of Kings.